Sati. Manu's third daughter, Prasuti, married Daksha, the Prajapati. She gave birth to 16 daughters. They were all married to Lord Dharma, except one of them whose name was Sati. Sati was a great devotee of Lord Shiva. She worshipped him at all times with intense devotion. Ultimately, Shiva and Sati were married. One day, Daksha decided to perform a huge sacrifice. All the gods, rishis, sages, kings, and celestials were invited to it. The day arrived. Everyone was seated in the hall which had been prepared for the sacrifice. The sacrificial trough had been dug. The materials for the sacrifice were kept ready in golden pots and platters. The Brahmin priests had all gathered. The mantras and incantations filled the air. At this moment, the conches were sounded. Daksha entered the sacrificial hall. The entire assembly rose in respect. Daksha's head went up and his chest expanded in pride as he saw the honor that all the gods and sages were showing him. And then his eye caught sight of two persons who had not stood up. They were Brahma, his father, and Shiva, his divine son-in-law. Daksha prostrated before Brahma and asked his blessings. He then looked at Shiva, who continued to sit quietly. This Daksha could not bear. He was terribly angry. He lost his temper and abused Shiva in front of all the guests. He said, "You are a shameless person. I know you are jealous of my wealth and position. I have never seen anyone more ungrateful than you. I have given you in marriage my gifted and accomplished daughter, and yet you have dared to show me disrespect." To the Devas, he said, "Look at him. He knows no difference between purity and impurity, respect and disrespect. He roams around in the cremation grounds, his body covered with ashes. He should be called Ashiva, the inauspicious, and not Shiva, the auspicious." Then he poured a little water into his palm and sipped it up. The entire assembly looked shocked and horrified as he pronounced the curse. "Henceforth, you will never get the share of any sacrifice. This should teach you a lesson." All through this, Shiva remained calm and composed, never uttering a single word in anger or protest. But one of his followers called Nandishwara could not swallow this insult to his beloved Shiva. Quickly, he too sipped a little water and in turn cursed Daksha, saying, "Shiva hates no one. It is Daksha who sees differences around him. He considers his body to be all in all. He will forever remain chained to the path of sacrifice and ritual. Being fond of the body, he will be extremely attached to women and he will soon acquire a face like that of a goat. The assembled Brahmins who support him will forever be caught up in the cycle of birth and death. They will crave wealth and worldly enjoyments. They will make a profession of their learning and tapas." Bringu, the leader of the Brahmins, uttered a counter curse on Nandi and the followers of Shiva. "They shall adorn their bodies with ashes and bones, and with their hair loose, they shall frequent the cremation grounds. Those who forget that Narayana is at the root of all things in the world shall attain only the tamasic Shiva, the lord of Bhutas and Pishachas." Now there was confusion all around. People had never heard such terrible curses before. Quietly, Shiva got up and left the hall. His followers too walked behind him. From that time onwards, there was constant enmity between the followers of Shiva and those of Daksha. Sometime later, Brahma made Daksha the head of the Prajapatis. Daksha's pride knew no bounds. He decided now to perform a yajna on a lavish scale. This was the Brihaspati Yajna. To this sacrifice, all the inhabitants of the three worlds were invited, except Shiva and his divine consort Sati. When Sati heard of the elaborate preparations that were going on in her father's house, she also wanted to go and see it. Shiva pointed out to her that they had not been invited. She looked at him pleadingly and said, "Surely a daughter needs no invitation to visit her father's house. In the intense preparation of the yajna, he must have forgotten to invite us. Besides, I so much want to see my mother and sisters again." So at last, Shiva allowed her to go. Dressing herself up in her finest clothes and accompanied by her own personal attendants, Sati set out for Daksha's house. It was a queer procession. Sati rode on Shiva's bull. Her maidens went with her, singing, laughing, joking, their anklets making soft, tinkling music. Shiva's attendants too went along. They were the odd-looking Bhutas and Pishachas, their bodies covered with ashes and ornamented with skulls and bones. Thus, this music-making, trumpet-blaring procession approached Daksha's palace. But no one came forward to receive Sati, except her mother and sisters, who came out and embraced her. Her father even refused to look at her. Being afraid of Daksha, the other guests would not even talk to her. Sati felt uneasy at their strange behavior. Then she looked around and saw that no yajna offering had been kept in the name of Shiva. Her eyes sparkled and her lower lip trembled as she turned furiously on Daksha and said, "Shame on you! You have shown disrespect to Shiva, in whose eyes all are equal. You have ignored him on whom all the yogis and devas meditate as the supreme Brahman. I am indeed ashamed of this body which has come from you, you who care not for the soul in your attachment for the body." She then dressed herself up in yellow silk, made achamana, sipped water, and facing north, sat in a yogic posture. Then she closed her eyes and, concentrating the air and fire elements in her body, fixed her mind on the feet of Shiva. As the horrified guests looked on, her body suddenly caught fire and was soon reduced to ashes. There was now a great furor and confusion in the hall of sacrifice. People ran here, there, and everywhere. Even Daksha was sorry for what his stupidity had led to. Narada ran to tell Shiva what had happened. Shiva rose in a terrible fury and bit his lip in anger. He tore up a jata, matted lock of hair or band. He tore up a jata from his head and dashed it on the ground. From it sprang up the tall and terrible Veerabhadra, reaching the heavens in height, dark as a thick black cloud, his three eyes flaming like the burning sun, his teeth terrible to look at, his hair as bright red as the glowing fire. He had 1,000 hands, and in each hand he carried mighty weapons of destruction. Around his neck was a garland of human skulls. Standing there before Shiva, as if waiting to strike, he said, "What are your commands, O Lord?" Shiva said, "Go and lead my whole army. Put an end to Daksha and his sacrifice." Like a dust storm, Veerabhadra and the warriors of Shiva descended upon the yajna. The priests and guests huddled together in fear. Was it a hurricane or a band of robbers? What could be the cause of this approaching volume of dust? Before they could even think straight, the attendants of Shiva had started on their rounds of pollution and destruction. They broke the yajna implements and scattered them all over. They pulled down buildings, put out the sacrificial fires, ran after the rishis and frightened the women. Those of Daksha's priests and supporters who tried to run away were stoned by the followers of Shiva. Some were tied down, some had their beards uprooted. Some had their eyeballs pulled out and some had their teeth smashed in. Above all, using one of the implements of sacrifice, Veerabhadra cut off the head of Daksha. After thus completely destroying the place of the Yajna, Veerabhadra and Shiva's army returned to Mount Kailash. The terrified Devas now went to Brahma. Brahma and Vishnu, who knew what was going to happen at Daksha's Yajna, had kept themselves away from it. Brahma scolded the Devas for the way they had insulted Shiva. He said, "Did you not know that by a mere act of his will, Shiva can destroy the entire universe? The least you can do now is to go and beg for his forgiveness." Then, at the request of the Devas, Brahma accompanied them to Mount Kailash. There, under a large vata tree, banyan tree, sat Lord Shiva, absorbed in yoga samadhi. His face glowed with the calmness and beauty of meditation. Brahma then requested Shiva to pardon Daksha and his followers, to return them back to life, and to allow them to complete the yajna. He said, "You are the supreme Brahman. Let not your anger destroy these ignorant Devas. They have learned their lesson now. Henceforth, all the remnants of the yajna offerings shall be yours. Accept them and let the sacrifice be completed." Shiva stirred slightly and looked up with a smile. "I have nothing against Daksha. Why, he is as much an offender as an ignorant child is. But I have indeed taught a lesson to those who are led astray by Maya. Let them know that I care not for sacrifices on the material level, that I attach no importance to the body whatsoever. The limbs of the Devas shall be restored to them. Daksha's head was burnt up by the yajna implement, so let him have the head of a goat." The Devas were satisfied. They thanked Shiva and invited him to participate in the sacrifice. Brahma and Shiva went to the sacrifice together. Daksha, who had regained life and now had a goat's head, welcomed Shiva with reverence. His mind was now wise and purified. The sacrifice was performed. Daksha sat in deep meditation when suddenly on the wings of Garuda, Sri Vishnu appeared. Beautiful prayers of love and reverence burst forth from the lips of all. Lord Vishnu moved over to where Brahma and Shiva were standing. As they stood there, Brahma's face reflected the pride and happiness of paternal love. Vishnu shone with the very sattva of his being, and Shiva glowed with the divine bliss of meditation. Then Sri Vishnu spoke and said, "Only the ignorant see the difference between Shiva and me. The wise know that Brahma, Shiva and I are one. The one assumes the three different aspects for the creation, preservation and destruction of the universe. He who worships even one worships in fact all the three. Everything in the whole universe is nothing but the manifestation of this one great truth. Nothing exists apart from it." The Devas and Rishis present were overwhelmed. They prostrated to the triune and were blessed by the Lord's grace. Such then is the story of Sati. She was born again as Parvati, the daughter of Himavan. After years of rigorous penance, she got married to Shiva.